Gemar Chatima Tova. Gemar means may you cause. Chatima is a sealed, and Tova is good. So may you be caused to be sealed for good blessing. It means may you be sealed for a blessing in the book of life. Gemar Chatima Tova. If you want to say it short, you say Gemar Tov. Not Tova, it's interesting. I don't know why, it's grammar. So Gemar Tov, good Yontif. Technically that means may it be a good Yom Tov. It's not really a good day, it's an awesome day, but we say that anyways. Welcome, I'm Rabbi Paul Kipnis, one of the rabbis here at Congregation Or Ami, and with Cantor Doug Kotler, we welcome you here to High Holy Day services, to Yom Kippur services, here with Congregation Or Ami. Rabbi Julia Weiss will be with us for a little bit during the service. She's running an overwhelmingly well-organized youth program led, incidentally, by our teens, our madrachim, our teen leaders. And so she'll come be with us in a little bit. A few announcements. First of all, there are bathrooms outside there and above outside there. Go to any of the side doors and then go, I think they're in the back of the theater, just go around. So much is happening at Or Ami. If you haven't gotten it, sign up for our e-newsletter. Every Monday, I'm going to be hitting you with an inspirational 30-second video, and it will set your week off right to get you thinking and get you motivated to be good, do good, be spiritually centered. That's the address. You just sign up for it, and you'll get it there. If you're not signing up for that now, take out your cell phones and please turn them off. We have arranged for a hotline directly to the Holy One, so you don't need your cell phones to check in. The schedule. We're going to start here at 10 o'clock. The adult services here. Youth services and program are elsewhere. Any young people who are with us here today, the theater has asked, and we're so thrilled we can be with them. The theater has asked that teens and young people don't hang out in the foyer. So if you're here, thank you for being here. There are a number of times I'm going to invite people to stand. If that is good for you, please stand. If you can't, or the fast is getting to you, or physically you're unable, please stay seated. Direct your heart to the Holy One. God knows what's in your heart. There are going to be times that... skip that one. Health takes precedence over anything else. So if you need to drink water, please do so. But just do it in a mellow way. If you're on an eating program, Overeaters Anonymous, doctor's instructions, medical things, then sure, you need to eat. That's Jewish law. But please go out into the foyer, the lobby area, to one of the corners and eat there. Please no chewing of gum here in the sanctuary. We welcome all of you praying up in the mezzanine. Amazing, as our services continue to fill, that we have our own... there's a Hebrew word, I can't think of it, angelic host that are here. Thank you for praying with us there. Welcome also to all of you who are praying through the live stream. We know we have college students all over the country and all over the world. There are people just recovering from surgeries who are home, some in the hospital who are praying with us now. We have people from all over the country also praying in, so thank you for worshiping with us. Somewhere right about there on the screen is the live stream, all the words, so hopefully you'll pray along with us. And send us a text or an email or post something on Facebook or Twitter or Instagram or Snapchat or, you know, just print it out and send me a picture so I know that you're worshiping with us. In case of emergency, there are exits on the side. Please go out there and they'll tell you what to do. If you have kids in the youth program, assuming it's safe, in case of emergency, they will take them right out by the fountain and then you'll pick them up. If not, Rabbi Julia, Jen, and their staff will take care of them until you can get to them. For any medical emergency, let one of our ushers know so we can contact. We have doctors on staff here to on call just in case. Welcome. So we're going to be here for a while. Turn to the people in front of you, behind you, wish them a Gemar Tov, tell them who you are, tell them what you're going to break the fast with. special shout out to my mom and dad who were going to be here but weren't able to do it, so they're off on the Cape watching, and thanks for being here with me. Oh, that's my mom, says, your sermon was wonderful. Mom, I didn't give it yet. Just kidding. Page 108. To remind you, for those who are here the first time, this is our visual tefillah, visual prayer. Left-hand corner is the page number. Right here is our new logo. Notice it says your home with an apostrophe. You are home, or it's your home. It works both ways. Wow. And then right up here, you'll find most all the prayers and the songs. So if technology in the service makes you uncomfortable, look at me. Thank you to our Orami Chorale, been lifting us up so long. Betty leading it, to our musicians. You are awesome. Aaron for leading us on piano again and again, take us to newer and newer levels. Thank you. We look forward to worshiping and praying together. Page 108. The day has come to take an accounting of our lives together. Have I dreamed of late of the person I want to be? In my daily habits, in the way I am with others. We have remained chained too often to less than what we could be, but the day has come to take an accounting of our lives. I need to come in touch with who I really am, not my titles, not my possessions or money. Catch that last sentence. That's what it's all about. That's what Yom Kippur is about. To know that each of us, have the strength to bring ourselves closer to who we want to be. If you get that, you can go home now. The day has come to take an accounting of our lives. Page 111, please rise.
Responsively on page 112. We are grateful each morning for the rest that has come after yesterday's tasks were done. We are grateful each morning for the fresh promise of a new day, a day of new experiences, of warmth and friendship, of new tasks undertaken, new fruits planted, of efforts brought to fruition, and of bountiful harvest reaped.
We are grateful for the creative and nurturing capacities we have been granted, for the compassion to sense those in fear, in hunger, and in pain, for the opportunity to share some of our bounty with those less fortunate.
We are grateful each morning for the light of a new day.
Let's take a moment to really focus ourselves into what we are doing here today. Let me invite people to take your prayer books, close them, to, if you're physically able to sit back up in your seat, put your tushy back, your seat bones, put your feet down. Imagine there's a string going from your sit bones up through your spine, your head, if your body allows it, and straightens you up. Take your hands and either put them on your legs down or face up. Maybe you want to put your fingers together or interlock your fingers. And if you're able to, comfortable, close your eyes. And breathe in. And hold it. And breathe out. And hold it. And breathe in. And hold it. And breathe out. And hold it. And keep doing that. And out. We are here on Yom Kippur. We have three transcendent tasks to be involved with this day. Two of them are critical: to repair the world and to repair relationships. These acts cannot wait. The hours are ticking by and our life is passing us by. Think for a moment of all the work you still have to do to repair certain relationships. And breathe. Think about all the work we still have to do, you still have to do to repair this broken world. And breathe. Feel that load upon your shoulders. Recognize that you are important to healing this world. Your actions matter. You matter. Hold on to that because it's all true. But there's a third task, a third transcendent task that is important this day, and I want to share with you a gift from my friend Rabbi Rachel Meyer, who with eloquence reminds us of the spiritual work we have to do. We have to find our center. We need to heal our soul. We need to remember in the midst of all of the work we do, we need to remember that we are enough. So close your eyes and breathe. And out. And in your mind's eye, in the quiet of your head, repeat after me three words. I. In your mind's eye, silently, you are saying it to yourself. I. We're not going to repeat this out loud. I am enough. Breathe. When you can't find the right words, or you find the absolute wrong words, remember, say after me, I am enough. Breathe. When you wish that your body looked different or did things it doesn't or can't, after me, I am enough. Breathe. When you feel like the dumbest person in the room, I am enough. When you do the best you can with the best of intentions and your kids or spouse or boss or friend or lover still isn't satisfied and gives you that look, I am enough. When everyone in your life wants more of your time and you feel stretched so thin you can hardly breathe, I am enough. When you can't even articulate why you were just so sad, say it to yourself, you know the words. Or when you feel guilty for being so damn happy, say it. When you are bone weary or exhausted by the world and all you can manage is to eat a bowl of cereal or not and stare at the wall, say it. When it seems like everyone has a better job or more friends, a cooler social life, more money, a nicer apartment or house, and generally the key to happiness that you seem to be missing, say it to yourself. I am enough. When your relationship with your family is messy and stressful or just completely non-existent, say it out loud with me. I am enough. When things seem like they should be easy, fill you with anxiety and dread, say it aloud, I am. When you want desperately to manifest things that seem so far out of your grasp, say it, I am. When you have grand visions and big dreams and life just looks so very different, say it, I am. And also remember, that being enough doesn't mean that we can't do better. Being enough doesn't mean that we don't have to repair those relationships. It doesn't mean we don't have to heal the world. It doesn't mean that we don't have to try harder to be the best people we can be. It just means that for the moment, say it, I am enough. Our prayers these days ask the Holy One of Blessing to open the gates of repentance to us. But the real challenge of these days is whether we will open the gates of our hearts to ourselves and whether we will be brave enough to keep them open. So for one moment, look in that mirror and see yourself. And if you're able to, straighten up those shoulders that are burdened by all the work that you know you still have to do. And look at yourself in the eye. In your mind's eye, repeat those three holy words. I am enough. And then when you're lost, when you don't know what to do or where to go or who to turn to, you can always turn to the Holy One and open yourselves up to the holiness. It takes an opening of your heart. It takes an opening of your mind. It takes an opening of your ears to just listen. When you're ready, feel free to open your eyes.
If you're lost, you feel afraid, and you don't know what to say, then listen to our God. Is there a question on your mind? Is the answer hard to find? Then listen to our God. Listen with all your heart and soul, and with all your might. Write them and learn them and teach them well, every morning and night. Close your eyes and listen. Quiet yourself, there's nothing to say. Stop all the chatter that gets in the way and listen, listen to our God. When the wind and the thunder finally disappear, there's still a voice that you will hear if you listen, listen to our God. You can hear it from the top of the highest hill, from the valley below. It can come from the edge of the universe. It can come from within your soul. Close your eyes and listen.
On page 116, we read responsively. On this Day of Atonement, we will not seek to escape responsibility for our own selves. We will not fault parents.
Sons of childhood traumas, the weaknesses we display, nor blame society, the economy, or institutions for their failure to make us perfect. Judaism teaches us that we are free, not free to do anything we want, for we have obligations to others, nor free to be anyone we wish, for we are influenced by others.
We are free to choose a dozen times a day
how we shall react to life's challenges, and in a small way, to mold ourselves to become better than we are.
On this Day of Atonement, we need to accept responsibility for our own selves.
Not cannot be perfect. Continuously happy and successful, always attractive, happy, and happy. We seek only to be better, to be a little kinder, braver, and more patient.
We seek to do a few more mitzvot, to share a few more simchas, to be at one with ourselves,
our values
and dreams, as well as being
people, our traditions, and our God.
Shema Koleinu Adonai Eloheinu Elohei Avoteinu V'imoteinu Elohei Avraham Elohei Yitzhak Elohei Yaakov Elohei Sarah Elohei Rivka Elohei Rachel Elohei Leah Ahel Hagadol Hagibor Hanora El Elyon Gomel chasadim tovim Vekone hakol Vezocher chasde avot Veimahot ומביא גאולה לבני בניהם, למען שמו באהבה.
Us in, or a big sign flashing up on the screen, which there's not, it would say, what's about to happen, this is what it's all about. This next prayer, Unatana Tokef, this is what it is. It's that big slap across the face. Wake up, folks. Between this Rosh Hashanah and next, this Yom Kippur and next, most of us will live, but some of us will die. Most of us will go on, and yet some will die by fire and some by sword and some by earthquake and some by flood and some by health problems. Some will be raised up to great successes and many brought low, low, low. And if you think you're immune to it, as they say in the Talmud, get a clue. This is what it's all about. This is why we're here. Why go out those doors and try to improve your lives? Why repair relationships? Why give more tzedakah? Why find your spiritual center? Because when I or Cantor Doug or Rabbi Julia visits you in the hospital, may you not get there too quickly. Or sits with your family afterwards, it shouldn't be saying, I should have, I should have, I should have. And you know those deathbed conversions where families work out relationships? Don't bother. Work it out now. And those times that you don't go visit the folks because you're too busy, you know you're going to show up at the funeral. Skip the funeral. Get there now. This is what it's about. Find your center. Find your life. Help lift others up. That's what today's about. Let's read and learn some more on page 120.
On Rosh Hashanah, it is written. On Yom Kippur, it is sealed.
Rosh
Who shall be tormented by the fire of ambition, and whose hopes shall be quenched by the waters of failure?
Who shall be content with their lot, and who shall wander in search of satisfaction? Who shall be serene and who shall be distraught?
Who shall study Torah for its own sake and who shall worry about grades and exams?
Whose life shall be intertwined with others, and who shall be independent and alone?
But Yom Kippur has not ended. The doors are not yet closed. We can annul the decrees. We can reopen the future. We can reclaim our lives. We can change the future by changing ourselves.
Rosh Hashanah yikatevun, uv'yom tzom kippur yechatemun, u'tshuva u'tfila u'tzdaka ma'avirin et roa ha'gazera. But teshuva, tefila, tzedaka make it easier to face the world, make it easier to confront what life holds in store, makes it easier to face ourselves. Teshuva, repentance, together, to look within ourselves, to change what... Tefillah, prayer, developing. Tzedakah, righteous giving. How many of you, when you grew up, remember at a certain point in the service, the Kohanim, those of the ancient priestly class, coming up to the Bima and taking their talitot and putting them over their heads? You remember this?
Yeah.
And then they would take their hands and put them in the live long and prosper, the sign of the shin. And they would bless us. Long ago, the Reform movement recognized that an inherited aristocracy was not our way. It was through wisdom and Torah that people came into leadership. But we kept the blessing. because it's a powerful blessing. It's the blessing, Birkat Kohanim, the same one that Cantor and I bless wedding couples under the chuppah, bless little boys and girls at consecration when they start to learn, little babies when they are born, bar and bat mitzvah, young people standing at the ark, blessing them, in which parents and children and grandchildren bless each other on Friday nights every day. So in our family, we have a tradition, and you're all our family, so let's do this. Hold the hands of the people to your right and left. Oh, how California. If you're comfortable. Too late on that. And repeat after me, but don't look at me. I already feel blessed by you. Look at each other as we bless each other, as the Kohanim did in the synagogues, as the Levites did back in the Torah, as we do regularly. Let us say, Yivarechecha Adonai v'yishmerecha. May God bless you and watch over you. Ya'er Adonai panav elecha v'yichunecha. May God shine upon you and be gracious unto you. Yisa Adonai panav elecha v'yasem lecha shalom. May God be with you wherever you are. And may God grant you and me and the whole family and the whole congregation and the whole world with the holiest of blessings, the blessing of shalom. Amen. If you're comfortable, give each other a kiss and sit on down. And so, there's another blessing of great importance that we say. It's called Birkat HaGomel. It's a blessing of the one who causes goodness. It's a blessing that's said after one survives an accident or one faces an operation and gets through it. Or if one gives birth, because back in those days, even still today, but giving birth was a very challenging thing and survival was in question at times. And those who faced mental health challenges day after day and find a way to get up and still walk forward. So if you or a loved one survived an accident or had an operation or gave birth or adopted a child or are going through or have people are going through mental health challenges, let me invite you to please, as a group, rise. Shh. We are glad you're here. And I know you are glad you're here, and all you out there. And we praise the source of life for bringing us still to this place. This version of Birkat HaGomel was written by one of my favorite cantors, Rabbi Cantor Kyle Kotler, son of Cantor Doug Kotler, grandson of a cantor, and even great-grandson of a Shaliach Tzibor, fourth generation. Maybe the best. I don't know. Well, you're the best. Sorry. Shouldn't have said that. Go ahead.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam HaGomel Chayavim Tovo. Shegimalani kolato. Blessed are you, Adonai. Blessed are you, Adonai. I'm so
grateful. Amen. Please be seated. Some of you may not know, but among the things I do in my spare time and in my work time and at night time and after the lights go out is I get on social media. And you think that I'm just posting to Facebook and Snapchat and Instagram and all that, but what I'm really doing is learning from others. My colleagues post their sermons, and I try to pick the one to download and deliver as my own. I'm kidding. And I like to put up questions and see how people respond to gain understanding and information, and when people share from their hearts and their minds. The learning is incredible if we use it right. You know, I've been thinking a lot this last year about what it means to be a Jew today. In this ever-changing world, you know, the priorities keep evolving, and so to better understand it, I've been spending the better part of a year talking to people. I've talked to rabbinic colleagues. I've been speaking to people at shul. I've been meeting with people at coffee shops and asking about it. I even put some stuff up on Facebook and Instagram to see what my friends and followers had to say, and I gotta tell you, the answers are fascinating, deliciously diverse, and wonderful, but they're all over the spectrum. And I agreed with almost all of them. I tried to figure out, how do I teach you all what being a Jew could be? So I took some ideas I learned from others, and I mixed in some of my own understanding, and now I'd love to share them with you so we can listen and learn from each other. Now, although I'm going to focus on what it means to be a Jew, I celebrate that our community embraces so many non-Jewish spouses and partners and friends. You, particularly, are among those who ensure Torah is passed down the door of a door from generation to generation. And so I wholeheartedly honor and embrace you and your gifts, which are also integral to building a caring community and transmitting cherished values. So thank you. Now remember, it's Yom Kippur, and we are here in part to think. Because open-minded intellectual examination is also at the root of what it means to be a Jew. Because in our millennia of Jewish living, ever since Abraham argued with God about the impending destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah, we Jews seem to consistently agree on one thing and one thing only, that we reserve the right to disagree. I hope that the ideas we share, many of them your ideas, spark carpool conversations, energetic exchanges at the break the fast, and then I hope will inspire you to compile your own list, your own definition of what it means to be a Jew. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we all did and we shared them around so we can learn from each other and bond closer to what it means to be a Jew or part of a Jewish family or Jewish community today? And when you do, I hope you'll send them to me because I want to learn from you too. But for now, buckle up. Hang on, because here we go. To be a Jew today is complex, and we're going to get into that. To be a Jew is to recognize that we are a people first, a religion second, and a series of gastronomic identities third. To be a Jew is to be the inheritor of an age-old tradition of stories and rituals, values and visions, mitzvot of good deeds and commandments to guide our lives, all designed to keep us a mamlechet kohanim and a goy kadosh, a community of priests and a holy nation. To be a Jew is to embrace l'dor v'dor, that idea of passing down something sacred from one generation to another. To be a Jew is to dive into the smorgasbord of sacred pathways to holy living, those 613 mitzvot, ritual commandments and ethical ones, communal and individual, holy day and food-based rites. To mine the Jewish ways of living for sacred opportunities, we say, asher kiddushanu b'mitzvotav, whose makes us holy through these sacred acts, to discover time-tested pathways to spiritual grounding. To be a Jew is to show up at synagogue, to be with your community, to sit with family or the memory of your family, to stand before the Holy One, whether you believe he, she, it exists or aren't sure or completely don't, because you know that something significant may happen here for your soul or your body or your mind. To be a Jew is to enjoy bagels and lox or simis and brisket or Persian ubgusht or Moroccan moufleta or hamless breakfast, or waiting 6 hours between meat and milk, or perhaps for some, eating that bacon-wrapped scallop because you find no meaning in the Jewish prohibitions regarding food, but you totally embrace Jewish ethical values, which you will stand up for till the day you die. To be a Jew is to wonder where God is when bad things happen to good people, and where God was when bad things happened to our people, like the Holocaust and the Inquisition and the pogroms and the recent death of Lisa, a 51-year-old congregant mother of four, and the Holocaust. Why did that Holocaust happen, God? 6 million of our people murdered, 1.5 of them children, 5 million others? Really? God, where were you? And to wonder where God was when bad things happened to other people too, like the 1.5 million murdered in the Armenian genocide and the almost 3 million in the Cambodian genocide and the 1.2 million in the Rwandan genocide and the many Sudanese Darfurans during the first genocide of this century, and that mom who died too young. God, where are you? Asks the Jew. To be a Jew is to cry never again, because our moral compass points to the dangers for our people and shines also a light on the dangers for all people. Because when we take our eye off that ball, the ball being equity and equality for all people, regardless of their gender or skin color, sexual orientation, country of origin, immigration status, age, or religion, we are forgetting that that same ball that is thrown out at others will ultimately find its way flying back at a Yiddish cup, a Jewish head. So to be a Jew, yes, is to sometimes bob and weave, to exist in a world of increasing extremes, religious, political, ideological, to live in that increasingly narrow space between those extremes. To be a Jew is to be a champion for democracy in all its forms, embracing freedom of speech because Abraham argued with God, and freedom of assembly because Jews had to gather in secret during the Inquisition, and freedom of religion fought so bravely by Hanukkah's Judah Maccabee and those Russian refuseniks in the 70s, and to freedom of the press, because what is the Talmud if not a journal of intellectual challenges to the status quo? And because we know that throughout history, when the majority begins to infringe upon the rights of the minority, eventually the Jew becomes a target. To be a Jew is to be like that plant, right? The wandering Jew, ever prepared to wander and set down new roots, because no matter how cozy we are with the people in power, our place is never eternally protected, even when we are in the inner circle, as the doctors of kings or the finances of fiefdoms or even the daughters and son-in-laws of president, because to be a Jew is to remember our Jewish ancestors who were wandering Jews, who were forced to immigrate and break laws and forge papers and lie and illegally cross borders to save their lives and thankfully to save a lot of ours in this room too. Now, to be a Jew is to show up at Shul on Yom Kippur, to be excited and prayerful and doubtful, to be irritated by some of your rabbi's ideas, yet wondering just a bit whether he might be onto something, even in the words that make you uncomfortable or even angry. To be a Jew is to point out the anti-Semitism of the extreme left, rejecting its deceptive claims that it is not anti-Semitic, just anti-Zionist and opposed to Israel's policies. But if one studies the origin, current leadership, and the effects of their teaching, one discovers that their anti-Israel words and actions mask a virulent form of Jew hatred that is dangerous to Jews and endangers the pursuit of democracy championed by our beloved America. And to be a Jew is to point out the anti-Semitism of the extreme right that underlies the white supremacist movement and its sister nationalist movement, that claims not to be anti-Semitic, even though they speak with coded words and not so coded words used throughout history by pogrom instigators and genocidal maniacs and other Jew haters, words that are repeated by their leaders and ours that are dangerous to the Jews and endanger the pursuit of democracy championed by our beloved America. To be a Jew is to remember that when here or abroad, the far left and the far right, each absolving themselves of the charge of anti-Semitism, still get back to the same place, namely, that Jews are the root of the world's evils, we find ourselves in a terrifying, dangerous chapter that doesn't end well for any of us. And if you really think that today's thugs are inherently different, or the lefts are worse than the rights, or the rights are worse than the lefts, then go reread your history. Both are dangerous. To be a Jew is to talk about tough issues, like corned beef or pastrami, like matzo balls, fluffy or firm, and what's the best direction for American public policy, and knowing that we will argue. But we do so with respect, because even when we want to throttle those who disagree with us, we recognize as Jews that within our conversational partner, there exists Selem Elohim, a shared humanity. To be a Jew is lo ta'amod al dam re'acha, not to stand idly by while our neighbor bleeds, be that the bleeding of our Jewish or our Sikh neighbors, the Muslim doctor down the street, the Asian accountant with the balance sheet, the Hispanic woman who works in the store, the African-American social worker who helps the poor, or the trans youth who are on the edge of killing themselves because though he was born looking one way, she knows she really is another. We all bleed red. To be a Jew is to be radically inclusive, because we are a mosaic of Moses' people. So we embrace children with learning differences and adults with mental illness. And we embrace interfaith families and multi-ethnic couples and Jews of color. And the divorced woman and the single man and the widow and the widower and the gender fluid and the gender queer and the older couples and the younger families and the teens. Oh, those amazing teens, so deliciously on the edge of their identity search, who call Judaism and or Ami their second home. Because here they, like so many of you, feel uniquely welcomed, valued, and loved unconditionally. To be a Jew is to be concerned about Jews everywhere. Kol Yisrael Arevim Zeh B'Zeh. Every Jew is responsible for every other Jew, and to act on their behalf. Through the Joint Distribution Committee and AIPAC and J Street and Hillel and Reform College groups and Jewish Family Service and Federation's new Jewish Survivors Project, check that out, and all the other Jewish-focused organizations that strengthen our people. And to be a Jew is to form coalitions with righteous Gentiles to help other people too. And thus we fell about the work of Israel, that Israeli organization which partners to help people caught in disasters anywhere, including Syrian refugees, or Jewish World Watch that stands up against genocide everywhere, or New Israel Fund, which is fostering coexistence between Israeli Jews and Israeli Arabs. And speaking of Israel, to be a Jew is to have a heart ever turning to that Eretz Zavat Chalav U'Dvash, that land flowing with milk and honey, to celebrate our people's continuous, unbroken connection to that holy land and to the modern Jewish state. To be a Jew is to be inspired when walking on stones in Jerusalem laid down by our ancestors 2,000 years ago, and then to head over to the beachside cafe in Tel Aviv for something to eat, and then digging in an archaeological dig to rediscover our people's past connection to the land, or learning how to cook Mizrahi food in Beersheba, or wherever we are in the world, turning and praying toward the Holy Land. Our land. To be a Jew is also to recognize that the land is also claimed by another people, the Palestinians, who have lived there for generations under successive occupiers, and that that people's downtrodden status, for whatever the reason, because of their corrupt, murderous leadership, or their uncaring Arab state brethren, or the immoral continuing occupation, or more likely some combination of all three, nonetheless should bother us, should eat away at our souls. And even as it's so hard to figure out how to move forward, it should propel us always to dream of, hope for, and work toward peace. To be a Jew is to be part of that continuous age-old longing for Zion, the ancient land and the modern state. To critique policies when they fail the ethics test, but to celebrate the Jewish state always nonetheless, because we see Judaism, when we see Judaism flourish there, it ignites a passion for Judaism here, within our hearts and our souls. Yes, you have taught me that to be a Jew is to live and to struggle with all those layers of complexity and nuance, decrying the simple binaries of rights and wrongs, rejecting the so-called blacks and whites of today. And to be a Jew? To be a Jew is to strive for holiness, that refuge from the tyranny of things we try to collect and own, senselessly believing our Facebook and Instagram facades that suggest that these things bring us happiness. They don't. They won't. But Shabbat rest just might bring our souls peace. So to be a Jew is to light Shabbat candles and make kiddush and eat challah and bless our families and bask in the holiness of time, even if afterwards we put the candlesticks in the sink and go out to watch a movie or to dinner or to watch your beloved Dodgers strive to win. Or my Boston Red Sox definitely win again. And again, and again. To be a Jew is never to become complacent, never to trust the whims of the majority, never to forget that while its medical properties are still up for debate, you know that after a really bad day or you're feeling not good, a good bowl of your Bubby's chicken soup will definitely heal your soul. To be a Jew is to smell the spices of Havdalah, to put your arms around each other for Hashkivenu, to dip twice on Passover, to pack bags for comfort bags for foster kids on Mitzvah Day, because these actions transmit values that we deeply cherish. To be a Jew is to stand together, seeking forgiveness, praying for healing, requesting protection for our loved ones, and begging that this new year will just be a little bit better. And to be a Jew is to hope without end that Torah, the foundational text of our people, can give us insight into our souls. And while many of us never got to choose if we want Torah's values passed down to us, with Torah's help, we will transform ourselves and our world into beacons of emet, truth, and tzedek, justice, to fill it with ahava, love, so that each and every one will enjoy shalom, wholeness, and peace. To be a Jew is complex and frustrating and enervating and energizing and exciting and complex and nuanced and more. And sometimes it's hard. And often it's wonderful. My friends, it's Yom Kippur. It's time to look inward, to venture outward, to create a world of holiness through the work of holiness. May being a Jew or part of a Jewish family or part of this Jewish community inspire you to do just that, to open your eyes, to open your ears, to open your heart, to say, Hineni, I am here. I'm ready to get to work for the sacred work I need to do. Let's go out and fill this world with holiness, with love. That's what we do. Gemar Chatima Tova. May you be sealed for a blessing in the Book of Life. Amen.
Been wandering in the desert of doubt, searching for meaning. What is life all about?
There are so many paths, I could never know them all.
But I always felt there was a missing piece. Was I somehow denying an important part of me?
Then the voices of my people spoke. Now I'm answering the call. Hineni, here I am, ready to receive your holy plan. Openly, gratefully, let me be all I can be. Hineni, here I am.
Used to think this all was ancient history, just couldn't imagine what it had to do with me.
Stories and tales from another place and time.
But my roots go deep, and with each word I read, I could hear my father's fathers and the same words they said.
It's like they were all telling me, this history is mine.
Here I am, ready to receive your holy plan.
Openly, gratefully, all I can be. Hine me, here I am.
So is my heart, and I know I'm not alone.
Adonai, as these words are spoken,
I'm where I'm meant to be. I am.
Cheryl Bronstein, who's been singing and composing for us and with us for so many years. Incidentally, or not incidentally, she, in March at our Ora Mi One, our gala celebration, she is one of the honorees for her work in uplifting us at this time. The others just announced at the board are Ike and Brooke Prah. In March, come be with us. Hineni, here I am, ready to do what needs to be done. We are taught that Torah begins and ends with chesed. Chesed is love or loving kindness. What did God do for Adam and Eve? God clothed them. At the end of Torah, what did God do? But God's self buried Moses. And throughout Torah, more than anything else, we see glimpses of chesed, this loving kindness, throughout. Isn't that what we are called to do, to spread chesed, kindness, to spread love? Because what is love? Love is love.
As you're walking through the day,
make this world a better place.
Children will learn,
and their future.
Oh,
make yourself a voice of God. Be a sculptor for the holy.
That was amazing, and you should all be so thankful that they were the ones singing and not me. So, did you ever start out looking for something for one reason and end up finding something you didn't even know you needed? I'm Sari Radican, and several years ago, my husband Michael and I began searching for a temple where our three kiddos could become bar and bat mitzvah. We were already members elsewhere, actually the temple where I became a bat mitzvah and was confirmed, but we were finding that our oldest son's learning differences were standing in his way of feeling part of the Jewish community. We needed a place that could embrace us all, especially our son, whose severe dyslexia led one teacher to say he would never amount to anything. Any parent of a child with learning differences knows the pain of watching your child feel separated and left out. And it was during that time that I heard the saying that you are only as happy as your saddest child. This resonated so deeply with Michael and me, as our son, who was always, always trying his hardest, was being reminded daily in every aspect of his life that he wasn't good enough to reach his dreams. I still remember my first conversation with Rabbi Paul. I shared Michael's and my desire for our children to be able to feel a part of a community anywhere in the world just by visiting a synagogue on a Friday night. So long as the experience was positive, they would know they were part of something larger, something bigger than just themselves. This feeling, this experience, I told Rabbi Paul, was our primary goal for our children becoming B'nai Mitzvah. Rabbi Paul listened and, without missing a beat, told me that at Congregation Or Ami, our son, like every other person desiring to become a bar or bat mitzvah, including my better half Michael, would be able to do so. Then Rabbi Julia listened both carefully and caringly to understand our needs and offered amazing suggestions for engaging both our bar mitzvah boy and our two younger children into the temple's engaging learning community. Then, Cantor Doug spoke with our kids about their love for music and invited them to play along with other congregant musicians. You may have seen a few of them up here over the course of the high holidays. And even to bring him new camp songs that they learned so that they could be incorporated into the Or Ami youth services. After these meetings, our family joined the temple and became part of the family learning program that's now called Menshify. Twice a month, as a family, we would jump in the car and head to temple for our family and individual learning sessions. We explored what it meant to be Jewish. We found deeper and insightful meaning to the holidays. We went God shopping to find our own connection to God and met other wonderful families who were committed to raising their children Jewishly, with kindness and community at the heart of it all. Soon we were looking forward to catching up with our friends at Temple and learning something new that would keep our family challenged and communicating until our next family learning session. Our kids were happy and thriving at Orami. So you know what that meant. We were happy and thriving too. Soon enough, Orami became our family's third place. A third place? You may be asking yourselves, what is that? Well, I learned that phrase from Ray Oldenburg's classic 1989 text, The Great Good Place. For most of us, our first place is our home. Our second place is where we spend the second most amount of time, usually work or school. And then there is our third place, the place where we feel a part of something not connected to any obligation, but a place that enriches our lives beyond just food, shelter, and income. It's the place where we actually feel our community. It could be a place like we used to see on the television show Cheers, where everybody knows our name, or it could be your favorite place for coffee. Third places are not where you're required to be present. Instead, they are places where you choose to show up. And according to the author, third places are where we learn from people of different backgrounds and life experiences, where we feel safe to surface challenges we are facing in our own lives and in the broader world, where we are stirred into action, or at least introduced to those who are moved to take action, where we comfort and celebrate each other. Third places contribute to a life worth living. They root us, they restore us, they support us. Bottom line, they allow us to be us. Like for so many of you, Orami is our third place. Orami is where we learned how to grow as a couple and as parents while our children have grown from young children to tweens and teenagers. It is where we learned how to care for and be good friends to those whose challenges are more than even we as a very strong community could overcome. Orami is where we allowed ourselves to learn how to be cared for by good friends after I was diagnosed with cancer and underwent with 36 hours of surgery. It was where we learned how to say goodbye to loved ones who were far too young to lose, and those, even though they lived long and beautiful lives, were too cherished to let go of. With every event and experience, Michael's and my connection to Orami grew. And what we realized is that while we originally joined Orami for the warmth and community that it could provide our children, it actually did the same for us. So where is your third place? For Orami to be the third place to so many individuals and families, we need to ensure that it has the ability to sustain itself. We want our rabbis and our cantor to be there for each of us when the need arises. We want our synagogue to provide exciting opportunities for our teens and adults to embrace the traditions passed down the door of a door from generation to generation. This year, with the funds we raised today, Orami will embark on exciting, innovative projects, expanding the Kid-ish Club for tots and their families, kicking off Menchify to teach parents how to instill menshy behaviors into their children and families, launching a partnership with Hebrew Union College, our rabbi's rabbinical school, to bring top American scholars of Judaism to our temple for deep adult learning. For Orami to do this and to continue to do for others what it has done for our family, it needs our support, our financial support. This is our congregation. This is our community, our second home, our third place. Some of you pre-pledged with the rabbis, and we thank you for that. Some of you pledged last night, and we thank you too. This morning, we need to raise an additional $58,000 to sustain these efforts especially, and others throughout the new year. If you haven't had the opportunity to pledge this year yet for this High Holiday Appeal, please consider what you can do. Please stretch yourselves. We have a matching gift this morning of $25,000. every new donation pledged today, including increases on pre-pledges, will double in value. Consider this. Some will make a meaningful gift of $180, $250, $500. Others can donate more, $1,000, $1,800, $5,000, maybe even $10,000. All gifts are appreciated. All are meaningful, and all will go far to help Orami's holy work. If your business or employer provides matching gifts, we can now accept those too. Just check off matching gift on your envelope and the temple will be in touch. If you're worshiping via the live stream, please participate in this giving campaign so we can continue to offer the live stream. Go to orami.org/donate. And just like last night, there are big envelopes under your seats in the end and middle of the rows. And take them out and take a small envelope from inside, then pass the big envelope to your left. They will be collected in the aisle by the ushers. May your new year be filled with love, health, joy, and many blessings in your home and in your third place. Shana Tova.
If you haven't already, you can pass the envelopes, the individual envelopes, down to the end. Try not to put the envelopes back in the big bag, but if you have, pass the big envelope all the way down to the end. And thank you, thank you, thank you, and thank you. Someone passed me a few notes before we go, so I'll just share them with you as we get ready to move into the Vidui. Whoever ordered the pepperoni pizza, please note we do not eat pepperoni on Yom Kippur. Or pizza. As you leave here tonight, today, this morning, when you leave here, each year for Mitzvah Day in the first Sunday in November, Congregation Orami collects thousands of donated items to fill bags of comfort for children entering emergency foster care. We have received feedback from social service agencies that said, and I quote, "These bags have served as a lifeline for our children as they transition to their first or sometimes second or third foster care placement or move from one home to another. These bags give our children a sense of belonging and hope. It's a wonderful thing to see children's faces light up in the midst of a very challenging and stressful situation. This year, there are two ways to donate. When you leave today, one of our volunteers outside will hand you a Mitzvah Day flyer, which contains a list of items we are collecting. Simply purchase the items yourself on Facebook or Instagram. We'll let you know when things are on sale in various places and bring them in. We're going to collect 10,000 items to pass out in these bags. And then this year, if you want, you can adopt a bag, and then Mitzvah Day volunteers will go out and get what you need. Information is listed on the flyer. Please check that out. Thank you. Page 128. We move to one of the other most important sections of this service. It's called Al Chet. For the sin we have sinned. Notice that each one says we, not me or I, because the idea is that each of us have in some way contributed to something on this list from A to Z of all the sins around. And so no one person has to stand up and admit their failures, their mistakes, without others, their sins. We all stand as one, and we all say together these words. Now, going back to a time when people wanted to feel their pain in different ways, some people take their fist or their open hand, but usually a fist, and when we say Al Chet, they sort of pound their chest. Not pound really hard. We only have one doctor on call, not many. But it's symbolic, saying that I feel that pain that I have caused, and I feel it deep in my heart, and I pledge to do what I can, we can, to fix it. If you do that or not, it's up to you. Let me ask everybody to please rise. On page 128, we'll read in Hebrew and then in English. I'll start. Al chet shechatanu lefanecha, for the sin we have sinned before you. So we do the first four words in Hebrew and then in English. Together, Al chet shechatanu lefanecha, for the sin we have sinned openly or in secret. Al chet shechatanu lefanecha, for the sin we have sinned knowingly and deceitfully. Ve'al chet shechatanu lefanecha, for the sin we have sinned by denying and lying. Al chet shechatanu lefanecha, for the sin we have sinned by expanding our rights and diminishing our duties. Al chet shechatanu lefanecha, for the sin we have sinned by slander. Ve'al chet shechatanu lefanecha, for the sin we have sinned in business. Al chet shechatanu lefanecha, for the sin we have sinned by an arrogant attitude. Al chet shechatanu lefanecha, For the sin we have sinned by disrespect for parents and teachers. For the sin we have sinned by failing to welcome converts into the household of Israel. For the sin we have sinned by envy. For the sin we have sinned under compulsion or by free will. And for the sin we have sinned by disgracing the Jewish people, our beliefs and heritage. For the sin we have sinned by gossip and talebearing. For the sin we have sinned by groundless hatred. For the sin we have sinned by overeating and drinking. Al chetch ve'al kulam meloas lichot. Slach lanu, machal lanu, kaper lanu together. For all these sins, O God of compassion, forgive us, pardon us. In these ways we diminish ourselves and harm others together. Through envy and through hatred it breeds. In these ways we diminish ourselves and harm others. By denying our responsibilities for our own misfortune, by refusing to admit our share. In these ways we diminish ourselves and harm others. In these ways, we diminish ourselves and harm others. In these ways, we diminish ourselves and harm others. Ve'al kulam eloas lichot, slach lanu, machal lanu, kaper lanu. Together, for all these sins, O God of compassion, forgive us, pardon us. Page 136. We read together in Hebrew and in English. Avinu Malkenu Shma Kolenu. Avinu Malkenu, hear our plea. Avinu Malkenu Chatanu Lefanecha. Avinu Malkenu, we have sinned before you. Avinu Malkenu Chamol Alenu Ve'al Olalenu Vitapenu. Avinu Malkenu. Avinu Malkenu Kale Dever Vechere Ve'ra'av Me'alenu. Pestilence, war, and famine. Avinu Malkenu Kale Kol Tsaru Mastein Me'alenu. Avinu Malkenu. Avinu Malkenu Kotvenu Besefer Chaim Tovim. Avinu Malkenu Chadesh Aleinu Shana Tova. Avinu Malkenu, renew our faith in the future. Coming year, truly a Shana Tova, a year. Avinu Malkenu Chanenu Va'anenu Kien Banu Ma'asin. Asei Manu Tzedaka V'chesed V'hoshienu. Avinu Malkenu, though we may be unworthy, do not give up on us. Inspire and encourage us, for you are both just and loving.
Avinu Malkenu Chanenu Vanenu.
In a moment, we're going to take out the greatest gift God gave to us besides our children. We're going to take out Torah, unroll it, and read it. And because it is the high holy days, we are going to unroll that Torah so all of us can see. But here's the challenge. The challenge is that it's going to be unrolled for a bit of time. Traditionally, we stand when the Torah is unrolled. And yet, it's going to be a long time. So if you need to sit, sit, but open your heart to the holiness before you. And then if you want to stand, stand, as is tradition. We have everybody.
Ki metzion tetze Torah, ki metzion tetze Torah, udevar Adonai mirushalayim, baruch shenatan.
Beginning, Reshit, right here. The end of Deuteronomy, Devarim, right there. And in the middle, arrayed before you, is a whole bunch of Hebrew. Okay. I know you can't probably see this, but all sorts of lines of Hebrew, but here there's a break. A four-line break tells us that we are at a place of a new book. So, Eile HaDvarim, these are the words. This is the book of Deuteronomy. So that makes this the book of Numbers. Ten, and it goes on back. We are going to read
down here. This is Hazi. No, we're not. We're going to read over here. This week's Torah portion is right here, this Friday's Torah portion. Ha'azinu Kam, Kanta Dag, our rabbinic intern, is going to lead us through the poetry of Torah. It's going to be amazing. But we're back over here, where we're reading Nitzavim. We all stand here. So I'd like to invite up our incredible bar and bat mitzvah teacher, Diane Townsend, who teaches all our young people and all our adults, and gets them to take this ancient scroll and bring it to life. And we have three readers. Readers, come on over this side. Actually, you know what? I'm going to have you readers stand over here. Okay? Close up. Okay. And for the blessing, let's see. Anyone who is either standing or sitting right now, why don't you do the blessings with us? Can we put the blessings up on the screen? So you guys do the first bolded lines, the cantor will do the second, and the readers will do the second, then you'll do the third, and then there will be another page. So one, two, three.
Baruch et Adonai, Baruch Adonai hamvorach le'olam v'ed, Baruch Adonai hamvorach le'olam v'ed, Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu.
Amen. And now, because of the incredible live Torah cam, let's switch to the Torah cam, the next slide there. And do I have my yad ready? Yes, here it goes. Watch the red dot connected directly onto the yad, a new technology that doesn't exist, but it sounded really good when the rabbi thought it up. David, somewhere over there, is doing it. We chant. Judy.
Amen. Atem nitzavim hayom kulchem lifnei Adonai Eloheichem rasheichem shivteichem zikneichem vishotreichem kol ish Yisrael Tabchem nishchem v'gercha asher bekerev machanecha mehotev etzecha ad shoev meimecha le'ovrecha bivrit Adonai Elohecha uv'alato asher Adonai Elohecha koreit imcha hayom.
Lema an hakim otcha hayom lo le'am vehu yihye leha le'lohim ka'asher diber lach v'ka'asher nishpa la'avotecha le'avraham le'yitzhak ul ya'akov Velo itchem levadechem anochi korit et habrit hazot ve'et ha'alah hazot ki et asher yeshno po imanu omeid hayom lifnei Adonai Eloheinu Ve'et asher einenu po imanu hayom. Ki ki hamitzvah hazot asher anochi mitzavecha hayom lo niflet hi mimcha v'lo rechoka hi lo vashamayim hi lemor mi ya'alelanu hashamayma v'yikachecha lanu v'yashmi'enu ota v'na'asena v'lo me'ever layam hi lemor mi ya'avor lanu el ever hayam v'yikachecha lanu v'yashmi'enu ota v'na'asena ki karov eilecha hadavar me'od b'ficha uvilvavcha la'asoto.
Fantastic, beautiful. The blessing for after the Torah.
Baruch atah Adonai.
Notain HaTorah. Amen. David, can you come up and help us, please? I'm going to change just a little bit, Cantor. We're going to roll it up now. I'm going to do my Dvar while we roll, and then we'll do the...
Works for me.
Reading Torah this week, we're Judy today, Judy Steinberg, who became Bat Mitzvah... some months ago, Linus Linden and Rachel Lotwin, two of our younger people, everyone can learn Torah. We have an adult bar and bat mitzvah program run by Diane Townsend, Rabbi Julia Cantor. Doug and I are involved in it too. Over a 2-year course of study, you are reading Torah. It is the most amazing spiritual thing. If you have not become bar and bat mitzvah, talk to Diane today, tomorrow. There's an information meeting coming up in October. By the way, if you already became a bar bat mitzvah as a kid and you're an adult, we have a new program. It took me a while to get there, Andy, but I finally got there. It's called Adult Confirmation, Kabbalat Torah, a 2-year course of study, twice a month on Tuesday nights, once a month with either Rabbi Julia or me looking at big issues in Judaism, and then once a month studying Torah. The week's parasha are important Torah portions with one of the clergy or our interns or other scholars. It's a great program. If you haven't done become a bar bat mitzvah, you should do that adult bar bat mitzvah class. It's incredible. But if not, come do the adult confirmation. There's also a meeting the beginning of October to look at that. And so we're going to start.
Zot HaTorah Asher som Moshe lifnei v'nei Yisrael Al pi Adonai be'ad Moshe Etz chayim hi lemachazikim ba etom ha'a me'ushar Shalom Hashivenu Adonai Elecha V'nashuva Kadesh Kadesh Yomenu Kadesh Yomenu
So as they continue rolling, what is this whole thing about? And why are we standing, aside from the fact that the Torah is out, so we stand? This week's, the Torah portion for this morning is called Nitzavim. It says, you stand here this day, all of you. Shh, shh, shh. all of you, before the Eternal, your God. Who's there? Your tribal heads and your elders and your officials, all the people of Israel, your children, your spouses, even the stranger in your camp, from the woodcutters to the water drawers, enter into a covenant with the Eternal, your God, which the Eternal, your God, has concluded with you this day, with all of its sanctions, to establish you this day as God's people, not God's only people, but God's people to receive this Torah. The people, you got to get the picture, the people were standing up there for a long time. Because if you think your rabbi speaks long, according to one tradition, Moses recited basically all of Torah to teach them everything that was going on. But he had them stand. What was that all about? Well, on one hand, standing makes us look around and see everyone else standing, and we feel like we're part of something larger. Also, when we stand up, we're attaining our full physical height if we're able to. And thus, symbolically, we're encouraging us to come to our full spiritual stature. I read from a teacher of mine, Rabbi Leigh Layton, wrote about that in the 1950s, Harry Golden, the editor of the Carolina Israelite, noted an interesting fact about integration. In his editorial, he observed that Southerners were in one part already integrated when they were on their feet. People stood in line together to board a bus. They stood in line to receive polio shots. They stood in line to check out at the supermarket. The problem was not how to integrate standing people, but sitting ones. So Golden made a proposal. He said, let schools be integrated by removing the chairs. Then everyone standing up, and if every child stood, then who could object to integration? Golden was touching on something important for us today. We are willing to stand with people we dislike. We just don't want to sit with them. With this Torah portion, think about it. After 40 years of wandering in the wilderness, I don't know about you, but all those Israelites probably were not friends. I mean, get your whole family crowd together for what? 20 minutes, an hour and a half, and then they're decidedly not. We take the picture within the first 5 minutes, so we have it, and then it's there. That's precisely what Moses understood, that when we stand, our emotions to dislike others do not tend to get in the way, and we can concentrate on our common humanity. So Moses had people stand before God. As these Yamim Noraim move on and tonight come to a close, let us think about the fact that we too, each of us, have made our share of enemies. We too have people that we have harmed or hurt who don't like us, who we don't like. But nonetheless, we stand together before God, united as a people, as a community, as a congregation, and because we are standing just for a moment, we can disregard our differences and draw closer to the promise of shalom. Now, wouldn't that be an awesome lesson to take back home together from these high holidays? That and the number of a good chiropractor. You may be seated. Today, we take a moment, now that we've read Torah, imagining it's still out, but it's with us, and we take a moment to say a blessing for those who are in need of healing, those who are struggling with physical illness and spiritual turmoil, those dealing with mental illness or spiritual struggle. We as a community, particularly Orami, but Judaism as a whole, is opening and opening and opening to recognize that we are a perfect
group of people, each of whom is a little bit broken too. So as one, let's say the names of those for whom we're asking for blessings of healing. Say their name and their relationship to you, like my Uncle Fred or my friend Sophie. We particularly hold those of you who are worshiping on the live stream who have just are recovering from illnesses or in the hospital or recovering from operations. We hold you in our hearts. So this morning we ask for blessings of healing for all of them and all of us, we sing this blessing of healing. Next slide. I went out of order right there. Look at this. Simchat Torah, we're going to unroll the Torah. If you thought that was cool, wait till we unroll the whole Torah around the sanctuary completely and look at, argue about, discuss, sing about the most exciting parts of all of Torah. For adults, for kids, for all ages, come. It's a great evening at the temple. Now, lower right, beginning of our new adult study program, we start with some fun, but some serious fun. Saving the World, Superman, Batman, and Noah. We're going to have Rabbi Shauna Bringegard-Bialik and Isaac Bringegard-Bialik, the rabbi and the artist, are going to blow your minds with pop culture and Torah intertwined. And then keep your eyes on your emails and your newsletters, because we're going to be kicking it off in November with the dean of Hebrew Union College Jewish Institute of Religion is going to come and speak to us in, I think, October, November. And then throughout the year, three other scholars. In January, the head of the Reform Movement, Rabbi Rick Jacobs, who goes to these 1,800 family congregations to speak, as he should, is coming to little old congregation RME to speak as he wants to. And so we're going to hear about the issues that we as a progressive Jewish movement religiously are dealing with here and around the world. Religious issues, intergenerational issues, and more. Flip the slide, if you may. Cantor Doug.
Yeah.
What you doing this year?
I'm going to Italy.
No way, really?
Yeah, really.
Okay, so
in May, and then I'm going to Israel, too.
In June.
Yeah.
Yeah. So listen, in May, it's an adult.
I got to check my calendar.
I hope you can be there. Yeah, I think I texted it to you before.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, I'll call you.
What are we doing in Italy?
Italy, technically, the Torah is Italy, Jewish, blah, 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 but we're calling it food, wine, gelato, and some Jewish stuff, too.
Okay.
It's going to be an adult trip. There's a few more only a few more spaces left. We're going to close it up at, I think, at about 30 people.
You know the word ghetto is an Italian word.
Yes. Yeah. No. But our tour guide is going to teach us, and you'll teach us, too.
Yeah.
I'm excited. Now, Israel is a family trip. That's almost closed. There's just, you going to go?
Israel?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Okay. I'm just vamping here. No, you can come, too. Seriously. Well, it's a long trip for that, but we'll have one when you're old enough.
We're doing bar and bat mitzvah.
Bar and bat mitzvah is there, but adults, kids, singles, couples, grandparents, grandchildren, yeah. All ages, that's going to be an incredible trip. Our tour guide for both, I can announce now, is going to be Lana, who's guided us at other times. She's an incredible storyteller. Come join us. If you want to go, you want more information, orami.org/travel, or email me, and after the high holidays... I recover, I'll get to you. Thank you. The other thing, let's stay on that slide so that it'll get stuck in their heads, but Congregation Orami sent out a couple of emails this week. We're launching a new young adult outreach program. Through this program, Orami will send care packages to all young adults who graduated from high school until about the age of 25. Our first package to celebrate the new year is free to all participants, as well as they'll get a birthday card during the year at no cost from the the clergy, with a small gift. That's our gift to our young people, members of the congregation, and those and those who never were. If you have people in that age, go to the Orami webpage, the RSVP link, and sign up. There's also an opportunity, if you want, to opt in for the Hanukkah and Passover care packages. To learn more, feel free to call Sharon Weiss and Karen Pofsky. There's some incredible people who helped make these high holy days possible. And we need to thank them. I'm going to ask you not to applaud. At the end, we can clap and thank them. They are incredible, and I'm worried that I'm going to miss some people, but I'm going to do my best not to. These High Holy Day services are the result of the collaboration of so many people that we'd like to thank, working some of them starting the week after these High Holidays. We thank our High Holiday Committee Chair, Richard Rutkin, his co-chair, Peter Kraut, especially also Karen Pofsky, our site manager for family services in Ni'ila back at the Orami Sanctuary. Thank you to their families and to all who helped out on all the committees to make it happen. Thank you to Mike Tachko and his crew here at Thousand Oaks Civic Arts Plaza for transforming this theater into a Makom Kadosh, a holy sanctuary. We thank our shofar sounders, David Weiss and Brad Cohen, our Orami board chairs, and our president, Fred Gruber. Photography by Michael Kaplan and Gray Becker, technologists Steve and Amy, to our incredible Orami staff, my assistant and our office manager, Susie Stark, Rabbi Weiss's assistant and school registrar, Jenny Mazzella, our bookkeeper, Lizette Tui, our youth program manager, Jen Quick, our communications manager, programming assistant, Andrew Fromer, to all our interns. We thank all the people who read and services, read from Torah and taught. Thank you to my wife, Michelle, to Cantor Kotler's wife, Gail, and to Rabbi Weiss's husband, David, and all our families for enduring the challenging weeks prior to the High Holy Days as we prepare and usually disappear.
Amen.
We're back. Don't know if that's good or not. We'll see. Yes, I do. Thank you particularly to Rabbi Julia Weiss, who will be with us for Yizkor in just a little bit, and to my partner, and to our master of music, my lover in liturgy, Cantor Doug Kotler. We also want to thank the incredible musicians, so many of them, our Madrachei Shira song leaders. We want to thank our instrumentalists on piano, Aaron Meyer, on oboe, Fred Bierstein, cello, John Farr, violin, Rebecca Bierstein, flute, Toby Kaplan-Stonefield, bass, Daryl Lieberstein, and the family service in alto sax, Emily Goldwater. Our soloists, Rachel Kelly, Rachel Sand, Cheryl Bronstein, Sam Gross, Cassie Benullo, Josh Friedman, Steve Greenberg, Michelle November, Brandon Holzer, Abby Adele, Anna Hiskey, Ella Sack, Leah Kelly, Madeline Menenti, Sarah Steinauer, and Deborah Tobias. And especially our Aura Mi Chorale, conducted by the incomparable Betty Ross Bloomer. When I say your name, please stand. Rich Abrams, Linda Blumenthal Kelly, Cheryl Bronstein, Toby Kaplan Stonefield, Fariba Cooper, Debbie Cutter, Chuck Donnelly, Susan Frankel, Steve Greenberg, Steve Goldberg, Donna Hennis, Carol Lieberstein, Daryl Lieberstein, Lawrence Linick, Alyssa Linick, Steve Greenberg, Ken Meyer, Ken Newson, Kevin Palm, Scott Pucker, Kathy Rutkin, Tali Sands, Deborah Tobias, did I get everyone?
Yep.
And to all of them and all of you, we say thank you. And now let's flip the slide. And hit it. Well, can we go into the food pantry and grab some food because I'm really hungry?
No? Maybe around 6:30 tonight.
Too late. Oh, that's because we have Yisker soon at 12:15. Okay, here. You going back to the congregation?
After Yisker, definitely.
For family service?
Family services.
You got to come to Nitla. It is so gorgeous. The teens are involved. The music is great. The food will wait. Come to the synagogue. It's going to be great.
And it'll be over at 6:30.
And everybody, you love being part of Aura Mi. It was inspiring. Come back. Come become partners in Congregation Aura Mi. Our new congregant level is within everybody's reach. You can transfer immediate family tickets into it. You parking?
No, I got a ride here. Be patient getting out of the parking. Don't ruin all the work you just did this morning by getting irritated.
You know, the key is not just not sinning between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, but making sure you don't sin between Yom Kippur and the next Rosh Hashanah.
Okay.
And lastly, look, folks. How many of you thought it was a little too warm in here? How many of you was too cold? Okay, so like it's about 50-50. So listen, so many people work. Kfel. Don't kvetch. If you have a kfel, email me. I'm going to share it with everybody, the chorale, the cantor, everybody. If things you loved, let us know. If you have a kvetch, hang on for 3 days. The people worked really hard. Then sandwich it between something nice and then a little bit of a kvetch and then something even bigger nice.
So if they have a kvetch, you want them to spend 3 days writing it, just a really, really intense one, and then put two nice kvels on either side, right?
No, I want a lot of kvels and a little bit of kvetch. We work, we try, we do. Okay, and if you have any serious ones that are of concern, Rabbi Stuart Vogel over at... he's a friend of mine, I'm kidding. Let me tell you what's going to happen from here. It's okay to laugh a little because you go deep and serious, and in a minute we're going to go deep and serious. At 12:15, in just about 4 minutes, we're going to start our Yizkor service. If you're staying, please do. If you are going to leave, when I say to, please go out. Please don't talk until you're all the way in the foyer in the lobby. Let people who are in here have the moments to be able to reflect. And we'll be back together at 12:15. Our services continue. Thank you.
Hey, Artie.
How are you?
Thank you.
Didn't feel it at all. Thank you.
Last year, but
A gentle reminder that if you haven't done so already, please double check to make sure that your cell phone is on silent or off. Additionally, I want to remind people that during the early part of the service, if you haven't done so already, please bring your Yisker scrolls and put them in one of the baskets on either side. This basket's a little full, so use the second basket now to make sure that sacred names don't fall on the ground. We are on page 177. We have come to Yisker to remember, to recall as individuals those whose lives were intertwined with ours in a personal bond, and to remember as a community those whose lives were ended because they were Jews. We as individuals and as Jews neither live nor die in isolation. We are part of a Jewish community. We are members of a Jewish people. Before we mourn our personal losses, then, we turn to the encompassing losses suffered by our people. Together, the destruction of 6 million of our people, 1.5 million children among them, is not only a human tragedy, it is a divine tragedy. The faith we had in humanity, the trust we had for the future, our confidence in culture and civilization, all these were also destroyed during the Shoah. They lie in nameless graves. Auschwitz and Buchenwald, Bergen-Belsen and Babi Yar, at Treblinka and Terezin. We shall remember them in their pain and their agony. We shall remember them as our own. We remember them because the world would like to forget them, to forget how they cried for help and the nations overlooked them, how they tried to escape and the nations excluded them, how they died in the camps and the nations ignored them. And not just the victims of the Shoah. In every generation, Jews have died al kiddush Hashem, for the sanctification of your holy name, just because they were Jews, just because they believed in you. What can we say? What can we do? How bear the unbearable or accept what life has brought to our people? All who are born must die, but how shall we compare the slow passage of our days with the callous slaughter of the innocent, cut off before their time? They lived with faith, not all, but many, and surely many died with faith. Faith in God, in life, in the goodness that even flames cannot destroy. May we find a way to the strength of that faith, that sure sense that life and soul endure beyond the body's death. They left their lives to us. Let a million prayers rise whenever Jews worship. Let a million candles glow against the darkness of these We pray, O source of life, that your Torah, to which these your children have borne witness in life and in death, sheds a renewed light in the hearts of all people, that all of them, nameless to us but known to you, shall not have suffered in vain. We mourn for the suffering and the loss of our people, even as we now turn our thoughts to those members of our own family and our congregational family, whose loss is our loss. O God, this hour revives in us memories of loved ones who are no more. What happiness we shared when they walked among us. What joy when, loving and loved, we lived our lives together. Their memory. Months or years may have passed, yet we feel near to them. Our hearts yearn for them. Though the bitter grief has softened, the duller pain abides. For the place where once they stood is now empty forever. The links of life are broken, but the links of love and longing remain forever. Their souls are bound up. We see them now in the eye of memory, their faults forgiven, their virtues grown larger. So does goodness live and weakness fade from sight? remember them with gratitude and bless their names. As we reflect upon those whose memory moves us this day, we seek consolation. We pray for the strength and the insight born of faith. Page 180 at the bottom. To the living, death is a wound. Its name is grief, its companion is loneliness. Whenever it comes, whatever its guise, even when there are no tears, death is a wound. But death belongs to life, as day and night belongs to day, as darkness belongs to light, as shadows belong to substance, as the fallen leaf to the tree, death. It is not our purpose to live forever. It is only our purpose to live. There's no great mitzvah that one lives long. It is a mitzvah only that a person's life was good.
I lift my voice when all is dark into God's hands. I place my heart. I lift my eyes when all is night, when I need help, I seek God's light. Adonai Li.
Page 182, we read together at the bottom. Adonai is my shepherd, I shall not want. You make me lie down in green pastures. You lead me beside the still waters. You restore my soul. You lead me in straight paths for your name's sake. Yea, though I walk in the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You set a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Eternal forever. Our generations are bound to one another when children remember their parents. Love becomes stronger than death when husbands and wives remember their mates, when parents remember their children. Memory conquers death's dominion when we remember our brothers, sisters, and grandparents, other relatives and friends. The deaths of those we now remember left gaping holes in our hearts, but we are grateful for the gift of their lives. We are strengthened by the blessings which they bequeath to us and by the memories that still comfort and sustain us as we remember them. In the rising of the sun and in its going down, we remember them. In the blueness of the sky and in the warmth of the air, we remember them. When we are weary in need of strength, we remember them. On holy days and on yard sites, we remember them. So long as we live, they too shall live, for they are now a part of us as we remember them.
The process of dying is painful, especially if it is prolonged. But death itself is a transition, a transfer from here to there, a recycling of the body and the soul. Matter is never destroyed, only transformed. So too does the soul evolve, higher and higher, from instinct to inspiration, from haughtiness to holiness, from selfishness to service, from individualism to union, until it returns home to the soul of the souls, the Ein Sof, the Infinite One. Thus is the divine source of life magnified and sanctified.
In the garden there's a tree planted by someone who only imagined me. What love, what vision. I marvel at the gift. No fruit could be sweeter than this. The ones who came before me. As my people went from land to land, something passed from hand to hand. Study the book we study, it's the way we study the way. I'm standing on the shoulders of the ones who came. Shoulders of
of the ones who came before me. Today my life is full of choice. Because a young man raised his voice. Because a young girl took a chance. I am freedom's inheritance. Years ago they crossed the sea. That's come to me. I'm standing on the shoulders of the ones who came before me. I'm standing on the shoulders of the ones who came before me. So in the garden I'll plant a seed, a tree of life for you to read. The fruit will ripen in the sun. The words will sound when I am gone. These are the things I pass along. The fruit, the book, and the song. I'm standing on the shoulders of the ones who came before me. I'm standing on the shoulders of the ones who came before me. I'm standing on the shoulders of the ones who came before.
Page 185. Yizkor Elohim Nishmot Yikarai Shehalchu Le'olamam. May God remember the souls of my loved ones who have entered eternity. Let's take just a moment. The next four paragraphs are there for you. Memory of a parent, of a child, of a spouse or partner, of a loved one or friend. Take a moment to read silently the appropriate ones. Amen. We're going to take a moment now to try something we do almost every year. To take a moment to sit with our loved ones who have passed on, who have died, but to have a chance to sit with them, hold them in our mind's eye, and to speak to them. A word of caution: if the deceased that you're thinking about is someone for whom there are still painful open wounds, this might not be the right time to be thinking and speaking to them. You might choose another person, or you might choose to sit this one out. I'm going to invite you to take a moment and close your prayer book. If there's space around, to put it on a seat next to you. If not, hold it in your laps. If your body allows it, I'm going to invite you to sit up straight with your back to your chair and your sit bones down. Place your feet out comfortably in front. Imagine there's a string from your head to your sit bones, if you're able to, pulling you straight up. And take your hands and either palms up, put them on your legs, or palms down, or maybe put your fingers together or intertwine them. And close your eyes. And breathe in. And hold it. And breathe out. And hold it. And breathe in. And out. I want you to imagine that you're in a place, a comfortable place. Maybe somewhere at home, or at a favorite vacation spot, or a loved one's grandparents' home out back. Find yourself sitting there and relax. Now imagine you hear the door opening, or an area opening, and you see your loved one starting to walk in. You stand up if you're able to, or move over to him or her. See the eyes sparkling, see the smile you remember. Smell that scent. If it's comfortable, give them a hug. Feel that hug you so remember. Maybe take them by the hand and go sit down somewhere nearby, somewhere comfortable. And look at them. And now this is your time to take a few minutes in your mind's eye to speak with them silently. But in your mind, say what you want to say. Say what you need to say. It's getting close to time to say goodbye to them again. Say those last things you need to say. Hold their hand. If you're able to, you both rise up. One last hug. A kiss. Assure them that you will remember. Assure yourself that you are remembering. They walk off through a door around a corner. Breathe deeply and let it out. Breathe deeply and let it out. And when you're ready, you might open your eyes and return to us.
Gather here, crying silent tears, because you cannot talk to me. You can remember, I am here though I am gone, dust to dust. Life goes on. Think of me, I will become a rose in December. If you remember, I'll be a rose. In your thoughts and in your sight, I am eternal light. Hold the torch against the night. You will remember, in the flame are many sparks, touching lives beyond the dark. By my deeds I've left my mark, a rose in December. That bloom in December. So say the words that must be said, prayer for beloved dead,
and as our precious tears are shed, we shall remember death and loss are what we pay for finding love along the way, a gift forever, sweet bouquet, a rose in December.
Page 186, we rise. Pray with me in the middle of the page. O God, full of compassion, eternal spirit of the universe, grant perfect rest under the wings of your Shekhinah to our loved ones who have entered eternity. Master of mercy, wrap them in your holy presence, and may their souls be bound up in the bond of eternal life. The eternal God is their inheritance. May they rest in peace, and let us say, Amen.
Shochein v'amaromi Hametze menucha nechona Tachat kanafe hashkrihina Im kedoshim utorim כזוהר הכי המסירים לנשמות יקירנו שלחו לעולמם בעל הרחמים יסתירם בסתר כנפיו לעולמי ויצרור ביצרור החיים את נשמתם אדוני ונחלתם וינוחו ושלום על משכבה
So, having filled our ark with the scrolls of the stories of our loved ones, to entwine them with the stories of the scrolls and the stories of our people's loved ones, We now fill this room with the names of all those who we are remembering at this time of Kaddish. As my hand passes over where you're standing, please mention their names in relationship to you aloud. This Yizkor we are remembering. May their memories be for a blessing, as together we say. On page 187, we recite together the Kaddish. Yitgadal v'yitgadash shemei rabba be'alma divarach rutei v'yamnich ma'achutei b'chayechon v'yomechon v'chaye d'chol be'et Yisrael b'agala v'zman kariv v'imru amen. Yehesh me rabba mevarach leolam ulolme amaya. Yitbarach v'yishtabach v'yitbar v'yitromam v'yitnase. V'yithadar v'yitale v'yitalal shmei d'kudusha brichu. Leila minko berchata v'shirata. Tushbachata v'nechemata. Damiran be'alma v'imru amen. Yehesh shloma rabba min shemaya. B'chayim aleinu ve'al kol Yisrael, b'imru amen. Oseh shalom b'imramav, hu ya'aseh shalom, aleinu ve'al kol Yisrael, b'imru amen. Please be seated. A few words by way of announcements. Our young people are, some of our young people are still in the youth programs. If you have children in the youth programs, you can pick them up. They're all upstairs in the founder's room. When you go out the doors, you go out, and then when you get into the main foyer to the right, there's stairways that go up. Our services continue at 3:15 with family services, not here, but over at Congregation Or Ami off of Moreau Road in Calabasas. And then at 5:30, we have an hour-long Ni'ilah concluding service. We hope you'll join us. Please be slow and safe as you exit the theater. Gemar Chatima Tova. May you all still be sealed for blessing in the Book of Life. Amen.